Hey guys, I'm Renee.
I'm Marthea.
And I'm Demetrius.
And we are Sip and Unwine, a true crime podcast. Hey ladies.
Hey ladies, how y'all doing?
Good. All right.
Hey sippers.
How's y'all week been going?
Oh, my week's been good. It's been very hectic with traffic, but other than that, let's roll.
That kind of sucks.
I've had a great week.
Especially with gas.
Thanks for asking.
Well, that's good that you had a good week.
Yes.
I know that gas prices out there is kind of messing you up, Demetrius, right?
Ooh, oh, my gosh. Anybody want to send me a Cash App? Come on now. Let me know. And I'll link all my information.
Yeah. So all my grown and sexy sippers out there, you guys get ready, get comfy for all new episode of some good old true crime. So my first request is for you guys to get y'all's red cup, get a glass, get a mason jar, or whatever you use, and get your liquor, get it ready. But today's featured drink is Graham's Six Grapes Wine. So I'm not sure if people heard about this one much. I don't see it out like in restaurants very often, but it's one that I've found not too long ago. I mean, the alcohol content is 20%. So all the people who really like the strong.
Y'all know I'm happy about this.
I already know.
So it's Graham's Six Grapes, and it's the number six grapes on the bottle. And I'll post a picture of it on our Instagram page so you guys can get it. But yeah, 20%. So, you know, like I kind of do, but Martia doesn't like those punk ass 5%.
No, keep those away from me.
right. And you know, the 20%, this is 20%. So it's, you know, quite a punch. Okay. So now let's get into this true crime of the week. We're going to go back a little to 1970s where it all started. So let me set the scene for you for this first murder. It was January 15th, 1974, and the murderer severed a phone line and he entered a home of an East Wichita couple named Joseph and Julie Otero. He strangled the couple to death and also murdered their two young children that were in the house at the time, 11-year-old Josephine and 9-year-old Joseph Jr. The couple's older child, Charlie Otero, was a sophomore in high school when he found his family murdered after coming home from school. After arriving at the home, he saw his parents' bodies in their bedroom. Charlie originally believed his younger siblings, Josephine and Joseph, were still at school at the time, but later, after the police arrived and they did a sweep of the house, they found the other two bodies. Both of the children were in the house as well. Police did not have any leads to the case, and unfortunately, this was the first of many murders. On April 4th of the same year, Catherine Bright returned home with her brother, Kevin, to find a killer waiting with a gun in her house. Kevin somehow survived a gunshot wound to the head, but he was unable to save his sister, who was stabbed to death by this killer. Soon after that, a young man allegedly confesses to killing the Oteros with two of his friends. So you heard me say allegedly, right? Well, come to find out that this was a whole lie. The killer heard that, you know, they made her arrest, and I guess he got mad or, you know, wanted the clout, and he was mad that somebody else took credit for his quote unquote work. So a few months later, in October of 1974, the killer introduces himself to the police. An editor at the Wichita Eagle, which is a newspaper in Wichita, Kansas, received a strange phone call that directed him to a mechanical engineering book at the Wichita Public Library. Police find the book and there was a letter wedged inside, which reads in part, and this is in quotes, those three, and I'm going to read it the way he wrote it. These are in quotes, those three dude you have in custody are just talking to get publicity. The code words for me will be bind them, torture them, kill them. BTK. You see me at it again. They will be on my next victim. So he also included then known details of the Otero killings. The letter is filled with what authorities come to realize as the killer's particular brand of misspelling and grammatical errors, along with a distinct sexually suggestive signature, the BTK. So if you guys can imagine this, B, you can see the letter B. And then if you put like two dots in the middle, it kind of makes boobs, you know, a B, and then the T, and then the K at the end, which is like the legs spread out. So that's kind of.
So he had like a real life signature.
Right. So that's how he did his signature.
Oh, I never knew that.
Yeah, sickening.
That's pretty sick.
Yeah. On March 17th of 1977, another murder occurred. The BTK killer knocked on a door. A little five-year-old boy opened it, and the killer asked if his parents were home and fed him some, you know, some BS story that he was with the authorities and showed him a picture and asked, you know, like, have you seen this guy acting like, you know, the police or a detective? So, you know, the boy at 5 years old, of course, you know, wouldn't know the difference if it was a, you know, a real person, a real detective or somebody trying to, you know, do harm. So the little boy said his mom was in the bed sick and the little boy let the man in the house. The BTK killer made the five-year-old and his siblings and his sibling go into the bathroom. There he tied them up and locked them in. He then proceeded to tie their mother up, put a rope around her neck and a plastic bag over her head, and she died of strangulation. On December 8th, 1977, another BTK victim was discovered. After binding and strangling 25-year-old Nancy Fox, the BTK killer himself went to a payphone to point police to where his latest kill was. So basically, he's just taunting the police at this point. He said, "You'll find a homicide at 843 South Pershing," he bluntly tells the police. Then he hangs up. And then the police go and find, you know, a murdered Nancy Fox at that house, at that residence. The BTK killer really amped up his taunting with the police after this. On January 31st, 1978, the killer sent a poem on an index card to the Wichita Eagle. The poem begins with, Shirley Locks, wilt thou be mine? So unaware of the connection to the murder of Shirley Vane, that's the one where the five-year-old let him in to the house. That's her name, Shirley Vane. I think that's how you pronounce her name. It's Vian. I think it's Vian, V-I-A-N. I'm sorry if I pronounced it wrong, because that's all it said. It was just, you know, to the paper and says, Shirley Locks, wilt thou be mine? So the people just thought it was a Valentine's letter. So they didn't really. Wow. Yeah. So the mail clerk forwarded the card to the paper's classified department where it sat for a while. The BTK killer was angry that his letters to the media and the police didn't get the response he wanted. So the killer sends a more direct message to the Wichita-based KAKE TV station. He goes on to say, quote, "How many people do I have to kill before I get my name in the paper or some national attention?" End quote. Then he started giving the police a list of suggested names for himself, like the BTK Strangler, the Wichita Hangman, and the Asphyxiator. Wichita Police Chief Richard Lemunyan subsequently calls a news conference to reveal for the first time the presence of the BTK Strangler in the area. Quote, "We have no reason but to believe that the individual has the capacity to kill again." And that's what he warned to the citizens of Wichita, Kansas. On April 28th, 1979, the BTK killer lies in wait for Anna Williams, but gives up and leaves when the 63-year-old woman takes too long to return home. Less than two months later, Anna Williams herself, you know, she learned of her brush with death because she didn't know that he was there, you know, that he was waiting for her until the 2 months later.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. When he sent her, he sent her in the mail her personal items from her house, along with a poem attached, right? And it says, "Oh, Anna, why didn't you appear?" Like, how scary is that? Like, you...
That
dude! Yeah. Oh, my gosh. You're like, telling details
I'd be
never knew.
In my house.
Right.
Like, I'd be leaving everything behind and running.
Right. So right. This is 2 months later. So you like, you have no idea. You come home and you just go about your business. But this man was waiting in her house. Like trying to kill, like I wouldn't, yeah. Like after that, after I got my personal items
and
in the
I'm
mail.
I'm so glad he did not go back.
Right.
But, oh my goodness, that's so scary.
Glad he didn't, you know, glad he got tired and let her go. So on August 14th, 1979, the police were seeking help from the public. So authorities released the recording of the BTK's December 1977 call. So remember, that's the call that he gave the address where her body was located at. So tips came pouring in from the listeners who thought that they recognized that voice, but there was no significant information that came from them releasing that voice, his voice out to the public. So he kept going on, I guess, you know. So in 1984, Chief Lemunyan establishes a task force devoted to BTK crimes, and they nicknamed the task force Ghostbusters. So lame.
Oh, okay.
So lame.
What?
But I guess. But I mean, it was 1984, and you know, they had the popular Bill Murray movie Ghostbusters.
They're making a mockery of this whole thing.
I just hate that name.
But you know, they can't really reveal a name. Like, they couldn't link it to him. So I guess that
right,
was
just
alien
kind of. Ghostbusters just sounds so lame. But I mean, in 1984, that was a huge movie. So I guess, whatever. But yeah, so they were called the Ghostbusters. The task force, which included a young officer named Ken Landwehr, and I hope I pronounced your name right, who spearheaded the efforts to track down the killer. So after several years without a known crime from the BTK killer, he killed Marine Hedge on April 27th, 1985. Her body was found days later on the side of the road. The following year, he killed Vicky Wee Girl. Now, I hope I pronounced that name right. Wee Girl, W-E-G-E-R-L-E, in her home. His final known victim was Dolores Davis, and she was taken from her home on January 19th, 1991. So think about it. These crimes started in 1970. What, 74 was the first year? And this is 1991, and he's still out here killing.
That's a shame that he was able to get away with the crime for that long. But
right.
I digress.
Yeah. So for that Vicky Wergel, and I'm so sorry I'm mispronouncing that name, but on her murder, it was in 1986, her husband, Bill, returns home from lunch to find his two-year-old son sitting by himself and his wife, Vicky, dead in their bedroom. In the absence of other credible evidence, you know, the husband became the primary suspect in Vicky's death. Then the police never had enough evidence to, you know, really charge him, the husband, with anything, but he still had that suspicion of guilt all around him. And I think it was like for about 20 years later, 18 to 20 years later, until they figured out that it was the BTK killer. But I mean, that's usually what you'll do, you know, if it's kind of like the husband did it or the wife did it, whoever's the closest person. And since they didn't have any real evidence, you know, they couldn't arrest him, but it still was kind of hanging over his head.
That's so sad.
Yeah.
It is. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but so, you know, it kind of was over his head until they figured out it was the BTK killer, but that wasn't until many years later. So on January 19th, 1991, on the last kill that he did, that they know that he did, BTK threw a cinder block through a sliding glass door at the home of retiree Dolores Davis, and he strangles her to death and leaves her body by a bridge. So after that, the BTK killer stops killing, they think, and the BTK drops off the map for many, many years. So this is 1991. So now we're going to cut to January 2004. And this is 13 years since that last murder that they've known. The Wichita Eagle, they run a 30th anniversary piece on BTK because he still hasn't been caught at this time. So it's 3 decades later after the first killing of the Oteros. The Wichita Eagle prints an article recalling the terror the killer spread in the 1970s and suggested that he had faded from memory after so many years. So I think that they was probably doing that to kind of egg him on a little bit, to say that he faded from memory, because maybe if he passed away, then, you know, of course, they probably won't find him now or figure out who it was. But if he was still out there, and if we would say, oh, nobody even thinks about him anymore, you know, he was just something of the past, a little egging on to get his attention, and it worked. So on March 2004, that same year, the doggone BTK killer is back. And he just wanted to be caught at this point. So what he did was, the Wichita Eagle receives an envelope from someone named Bill Thomas Killman, which are the initials of BTK, containing a copy of Vicky Wergel's missing driver's license, photos of her body, and the BTK's distinctive signature. So after all those years, he was quiet since 1991. And in 2004, when they ran this piece, he wanted to get his shine, I guess, or his attention. So it worked. He contacted the newspaper, and then he sent in the information on Vicky's killing. And this was a chilling message that the links to her husband, you know, that they thought that murdered Vicky, was actually the BTK killer who actually killed her. So I guess, you know, it was the cloud was lifted at that time. So on May of 2004, he mailed some things to the KAKE TV station. He sent them a phony ID, chapter titles for his BTK biography, because he was, I guess, writing a biography of what he did. You know, because he had time since, you know, this was 2004.
He also had some nerve and audacity, too, because that's crazy. You know,
right. So he gave them chapter titles to his biography and then a find the word letter grid spelling out clues like prowl and fantasies and stuff. So he's still playing with them. So the BTK killer really wanted to be caught because, you know, on December 13, 2005, he leaves another disturbing package. After BTK leaves more messages in various public locations, a man walking through a Wichita Murdoch park stumbles on a garbage bag containing murdered victim Nancy Fox's driver's license and a Barbie doll with a hood over the head and the arms tied behind its back, the way that the police found her. And that's very creepy. But then I also ask, why is a man picking up a garbage bag in a park and looking through it? Like, I wouldn't ever think.
Right. Or something.
Yeah, like, I wouldn't think pick up a garbage bag that, you know, had stuff.
I would be too scared. I'm checking with that.
Right, But thank goodness that the man
looked.
But that's
why I'm wondering, was he homeless? Like, going through trash.
Looking for something.
But, like, I mean, I wouldn't go through a trash bag. Ugh.
But good thing that he did take it to the police and not just throw it in the trash, since it had, you know, that stuff in there that kind of linked the BTK to Nancy Fox's murder. So here he goes. You know, he's still acting up, playing cat and mouse with the cops. So acting on instructions from a postcard that he mailed to the KAKE TV station on January 25th, 2005. So he's still playing with them. Police find a cereal box on a road on the side of a Wichita highway containing a graphic description of BTK's first murders and another doll fashioned in a death position. There was a section of the postcard where it asked the police whether that they found his package at the local Home Depot. So, of course, you know, they didn't find one. They didn't know that there was one at Home Depot. So off to Home Depot, the police go. So after poking around in the store, trying to find, you know, whatever he left for them at Home Depot, the investigators learned that one of the employees found a cereal box in the bed of his pickup truck. And a search of the trash where they of this employee, because he threw it in the trash, in his trash, they found the cereal box and a message asking if BTK could communicate via a computer floppy disk without being traced. So he's asking the police, can I communicate to you? You know, can I send you information on a floppy disk? But it won't be traced back to me, right? So the police said, yeah, you know, of course, the police, it won't, you know, it won't be traced back to you or anything. So he told them, if it won't be traced, for them to send him a message saying, Rex, it'll be okay. So the police made arrangements with the Wichita Eagle with the newspaper, and they ran a classified ad that read, Rex, it'll be okay, along with, and they also sent, you know, the contact information where they wanted him to send the floppy disk. So I guess he got tired of doing handwritten stuff. I don't know. And he wanted to do it all on a computer. But if anybody knows anything, computers will be, you know, they track everything on you. So now let's keep in mind that they still don't know who the BTK killer is at this point. They're still, you know, trying to find out who he is. So a computer floppy disk arriving by mail is given to the cyber cop, Randy Stone, because he did send in the floppy disk to the police, and it uncovered the BTK's message about checking an index card for more information. He just keeps playing with them, along with the hidden metadata that reveals the disk has been used, because you know how you can go into a floppy disk or, you know, into like a computer file and see like the where it originated from and all that, like on.
Yeah, how all that works.
Yeah, but if you can go into the background disk. of stuff that's saved, especially like on a disk or something, and see like where it was created, who created, what it's linked to. It says it revealed that it was used by a man named Dennis, and the location was at Christ Lutheran Church.
What?
So, and then it had the location of Park City Library.
This is just too much information I never knew. Wow. Right.
So now listen to this. So within seconds, because, you know, the internet be telling you everything, they did an internet search on Christ Lutheran Church and it revealed somebody there named Dennis Rader. But get this, y'all. He was the president of the church named Dennis Rader.
Get out of here.
Yeah. So he was a church president at Christ Lutheran Church. So already armed with his DNA that they got off of some of the other victims from the, you know, the Ghostbusters there, that task force, the Ghostbusters, was able to get DNA. So they've been holding on to it. And his team learned that Dennis Rader's daughter, Carrie, which I don't know how they found out, but they found out that she was at a hospital getting a pap smear. So the hospital turns over a sample of her DNA, and it matched the BTK DNA. Dennis Rader's daughter's DNA matched, you know, the stuff of what he left on the bodies from back in the day. Wow. So they kind of got the person. Now they know that it's a link there. So on February 25th, 2005, Dennis was heading home from the office to have lunch with his wife, where he was pulled over by a line of police cars trailing him, and he was taken into custody. So he confesses after being confronted with the DNA evidence. He didn't make it really hard for the police after he got caught. So he was just mad that detectives lied to him about the security of communicating through computer disks. Like, he was like, dude, why didn't you tell me like you could find out who I was? Like, yeah, no.
And the nerve of him to think that they would be honest in
right,
their response
right.
to him too, though.
You know, yeah, yeah, you guys lied. You said you couldn't find me. Yeah, okay. So the BTK's arrest is announced at the Wichita City Hall the following day, drawing applause from the audience that was gathered there. So now let me tell you a little bit about the BTK killer, Dennis Rader. After high school, Rader joined the Air Force in 1963. And after an honorable discharge in 1970, he married Paula Dietz and settled down in Park City, Kansas. Dennis worked as an assembler at a local Coleman camping supply factory. In November 1974, he landed a position as an installer for ADT, you know, the nationwide home security company.
Oh, wow.
So he was able to go house to house and know how everything is hooked up and know how to disarm all this stuff.
See, man, this is, oh,
yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah. So that job was the first of a series of positions that gave Rader, you know, access to Wichita homes in an official capacity, because, you know, people will just let you in and he sees what's going right. on or what's, you know, who's there. So during those killing years, Dennis attended Wichita State University and he graduated in 1979 with a degree in administration of justice. Child. So he's still just carrying on life and killing people on the side. But in 1988, Dennis Rader left ADT. The following year, he became the Wichita Field Operations Supervisor for the 1990 census. So if you guys know anything about the census,
more
you know, they go people.
Wow.
Door to door, talk to people, mm-hmm. and people trust them, and people talk to them and tell them who's in the house, you know, how many people live wow. here. Yeah, so... Among his jobs with the census, he was verifying new residential addresses around the town. So he was, you know, had access to people. In 1991, he became a uniformed code officer for Park City. So a code officer, if you guys think about it, is like somebody who, you know, like if whatever the city's ordinances or codes, make sure that they stay up to it. So you can't have like your grass so high or you can't have a structure in front of your house, mm-hmm. you know, stuff like that. So he's able to okay. walk in neighborhoods, door to door, knock on doors, and people will talk to him because he has his uniform on, has a little, probably wow. a little nice little car that says city ordinance people, you know? So he has these jobs where he's able to go into the neighborhood and talk to people
and people's trust.
Knock on doors. And it doesn't cause any suspicion. Because
while he's taking notes of his next victim.
Yes, oh. yes, because he's there in like a quote unquote official capacity, but he's also kind of scoping the scene to see, you know, where he goes next, which is disgusting. So he also was a scout leader, Boy Scouts. He was also a scout leader working with a local park that included his son. So his
wait
son
a minute, wait a minute.
Boy Scouts. Yes.
wow. Oh, my wow. God.
He really was blending in with society.
I mean, you could not. That's why they couldn't find him.
Yeah.
He was right in front of them.
Right, right. Exactly. So he was just kind of hiding in plain sight. Yes. And then also the president of the church, you wouldn't think, you know, No, that's just Dennis. Yeah, we know him around town. He comes and go, you know, whatever. So yeah. So let's jump to the court case.
With the male killers, I'm starting to notice a trend with the male killers that we cover, that they're upstanding citizens, you know, in the background of being crazy killers. That is just,
that's why
trusted. They are so trusted. People just trust their demeanor. Like, no, he's a cool guy.
When I've been hearing cases, when I hear cases of people, you know, like they say their next door neighbor had like a brothel going on in the house, and people are like, I didn't suspect that. And I always will be like, you don't know what's going on in people's houses. You know, like, right. You don't know what is going on. So I wouldn't put nothing past anybody, but that's thick on a whole nother level. Cause I mean, he was trusted so much around the city, and he just took advantage of that. So now let's jump to the court case. So Dennis, he waived his right for a preliminary hearing, so that hearing only lasted a few short minutes, and then it was over since he waived his rights. 2 weeks later, after the that preliminary hearing, Rader entered a not guilty plea. 2 months after that, Rader's pleaded guilty to the BTK killings, only 2 months, and then I guess he had a change of heart. So he caught the prosecutors off guard by pleading guilty to 10 counts of first-degree murder. Rader then provides the court with explicit details on how he selected, stalked, and killed each of his victims.
So, as I'm to understand it, then on the 17th of March, 1977, you saw this little boy go into a residence, and you tried another residence. You tried another residence. No one was there, so you went to the residence with the little boy.
And I watched where he went.
What happened then?
After I tried this once, the residence, nobody came to the door. I went to this house where he went in, knocked on the door, and told him I was a private detective. Showed him a picture that I had just showed the boy, and asked him if they could ID the picture. And at that time, I had the gun here, and I just kind of forced myself in. I just walked in, just opened the door, walked in, and then pulled the pistol.
What gun? What pistol?
357 Magnum.
So you only had one gun with the pistol?
Yes, sir.
What happened then?
I told Mrs. Spian that I had a problem with sexual fantasies, that I was going to tie her up, and that I might have to tie the kids up, and that she would cooperate with me at that time. We went back. She was extremely nervous. I think she even smoked a cigarette. And we went back to one of the back areas of the porch, explained to her that I had done this before. And I think she was, at that point in time, I think she was sick because she had her night robe on. And I think if I remember right, she had been sick. And I think she came out of the bedroom when I went in the house. So anyway, we went back to her bedroom, and I proceeded to tie the kids up, and they started crying and got real upset. So I said, "Oh, this is not going to work." So we moved them to the bathroom. She helped me, and then I tied the door shut. We put some toys and blankets and odds and ends in there for the kids, make them as comfortable as we could. Tied one of the bathroom doors shut so they couldn't open it, and she went back and helped me shove the bed up against the other bathroom door. And then I proceeded to tie her up. She got sick, threw up, got her a glass of water, comforted her a little bit, and then I went ahead and tied her up, and then put a bag over her head and strangled her.
All right. Was this a plastic bag also?
Yes, sir. I think it was. But I could be wrong on that.
Okay, you put a bag.
It was something. I'm sure it was a plastic bag, yeah.
Now you say you put a bag over her head and strangled her. What did you strangle her with?
I tied her legs to the bedpost and worked up with the rope all the way up, and then what I had left over, I looped over her neck.
So you used this rope to strangle her?
Yes. I think it's the same one that I tied her body with.
What happened then?
Well, the kids were really banging on the door, hollering and screaming, and then the telephone rang, and they had talked about earlier that the neighbor was going to check on them, so I cleaned everything up real quick like and got out of there, left, and went back into my car.
Now, when you say you cleaned everything...
Well, I mean, put my stuff... I had a briefcase, whatever I had laying around, ropes, tape... cords, I threw that in there, that I had that I brought in the house.
Had you brought that to the Bride residence also? Or?
Now, there is some, I think there's some basic stuff, but I don't remember bringing total stuff like I did to some of the others.
Was this a kit that you had prepared?
Yes, I called my hip kit.
All right, sir. You left the Vian residence, and had you parked your vehicle near there?
Yeah, still in the same parking lot there, Dillon's, at Hydraulic and, what is that, Harry? Lincoln and Hydraulic.
All right, in count seven, it is claimed that on the 8th day of December, 1977, in Sedgwick County, Kansas, that you unlawfully killed a human being, that being Nancy Fox, maliciously, willfully, deliberately, and with premeditation, by strangulation, inflicting injuries from which the said Nancy Fox did die on December 8th, 1977. Can you tell me what you did on that day here in Sedgwick County?
Nancy Fox was another one of the projects. When I was trolling the area, I noticed her go in the house one night. Sometimes I would, and anyway, put her down as a potential victim.
Let me ask you one thing, Mr. Rader. You used that term when you were patrolling the area. What do you mean by that?
It's called stalking or trolling.
So you were not working in any form or fashion. You
well,
were just...
I don't know. If you read much about serial killers, they go through what they call the different phases. That's one of the phases they go through as a trolling stage. You're basically looking for a victim at that time. And that you could be trolling for months or years. But once you lock in on a certain person, then you become stalking. And that might be several of them, but you really home in on that person. They basically become the... That's the victim. That's what you want to be.
All right.
No, so no, I wasn't working, sir.
All right.
No, this was off my hours.
All right. So you basically identified Nancy Fox as one of your projects. What happened then?
At first, she was spotted, and then I did a little homework. I dropped by once to check the mailbox to see what her name was. Found out where she worked. Stopped by there once. Hillsburg, kind of sized her up. The more I knew about a person, the more I felt comfortable with it. So I did that a couple of times. And then I just selected a night, which was this particular night, to try it, and it worked out.
All right. Can you tell me what you did on the night of December 8th, 1977?
Now, about two or three blocks away, I parked my car and walked to that residence. Knocked at the door first to make sure, see if anybody was in there, because I knew she arrived home at a particular time from where she worked. Nobody answered the door, so I went around the back of the house, cut the phone lines. I could tell that there wasn't anybody in the north apartment. Broke in and waited for her to come home in the kitchen.
All right. Did she come home?
Yes, she did.
What happened?
I confronted her, told her there I was had a problem, sexual problem, that I would have to tie her up and have sex with her. She was a little upset. We talked for a while. She smoked a cigarette. While we smoked a cigarette, I went through her purse, identifying some stuff. And she finally said, well, let's get this over with so I can go call the police. And I said, okay. And she said, can I go to the bathroom? And I said, yes. She went to the bathroom and came. And I told her when she came out to make sure that she was undressed. And when she came out, I handcuffed her, and I don't really remember whether... Sir?
You handcuffed her? You had a pair of handcuffs?
Yes, sir.
What happened then?
Well, anyway, I handcuffed her, had her lay on the bed, and then I tied her feet, and then I was also undressed to a certain degree, and then I got on top of her, and then I reached over, took either feet were tied or not tied, but anyway, I think I had a belt. I took the belt and then strangled her with a belt at that time.
All right. All right, after you had strangled her, what happened then?
Okay. After I strangled her with the belt, I took the belt off and retied that with pantyhose real tight, removed the handcuffs, and tied those with pantyhose. Can't remember the colors right now. I think I maybe retied her feet. What they had not already, they were probably already tied, her feet were. And at that time, masturbated, sir.
All right. Had you had sexual relations with her?
No,
before?
No. No, I told her I was, but I did not.
So you masturbated, then what did you do?
Dressed and then went through the house, took some of her personal items and kind of cleaned the house up, went through it, checked everything, and then left.
So, okay, Sippers. So did you guys hear how cold he was? Did you guys hear
that's
how he cold?
Terrible.
I know.
I just hope no family members were sitting there listening to this.
I mean,
they probably were. Yeah.
But he was acting like it was something normal.
Yeah. He was just like matter of fact, like just telling this is what it was. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I tied this person up. Oh, yeah. Yeah. I did that.
Got up and went to work today and I enjoyed my day with my coworkers. That's kind of what that translates over to me.
Yeah. Like it was just a normal routine. Like,
and then going to church on Sunday.
My daily routine. Right. Yeah.
In August 2005, the two-day sentencing hearing featured testimony about Dennis Rader's torture-fueled sex fantasies. So since he committed the murders before Kansas reintroduced the death penalty in 1994, as you remember, his last killing was 1991, the BTK killer received a sentence of 10 consecutive life terms in prison and a minimum of 175 years without the possibility of parole. So it's safe to say that he will be in there forever. Today, he remains at the El Dorado Correctional Facility in Prospect Township, Kansas, where his earliest possible release date is 2180. So it's safe to say he won't make it to that date. So he is currently 77 years old, and he and his wife divorced in 2005 after he was arrested. Can you imagine just being his wife and learning?
I was just getting ready to sit here and all say, this? Wow. Like, how did she feel about this whole thing?
Exactly.
Oh,
like, did you not see anything abnormal about his demeanor, his attitude?
But I guess because like how cold something. He is, probably not. You know, I don't, because, you know, sometimes I'll probably think she knew. Yeah, she knew that he was up to something. But I don't think so. Like, it didn't.
And what about his kids? Like, what kind of father was he to them? I'm gonna try to look him up because I wonder if they focus on his family. There's like a show that comes on where they talk to the family of high profile murderers.
Yes, I've seen that. I've seen two episodes.
And I don't think I've ever seen an episode of it, but I've always seen the commercials for it. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna try to look and see if he's been featured on there or his family. Because
I know he has a son and a daughter. I didn't see anything about the son. But I see the daughter, she has a book, or she did a book. I'm not sure when it was, describing, you know, because of course, well, I'm not saying of course, but she didn't know about the, you know, her father was murdering all these people either.
Yeah.
But I don't want to read that book. I didn't look it up just because that's just nothing that I would. Because I mean, she can't tell me anything. And I don't want to hear about how good of a father he was, or how he took her to the park, or how he took her, you know, like.
Yeah, it's amazing how you hear their
side. That's the part I'm intrigued about.
Yeah, see, that's part I'm just like, no, I don't even want, you're not going to humanize him and make him be like, you know, well, he was a good dad to me. It don't even matter. I mean, that might be the case, but I don't want to read about it.
And like, you know, you hear that though in cases like some of the family be like, well, I don't think he would have done this. And
like, but no, but they can't even say that because he confessed. So it's not even like they can't even be like,
well, I mean, like in other cases and now, and he is, now that's very special.
Yeah.
Yeah, we clearly know he writing signatures and
he said
making their body. Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, for other people to be like, I don't believe.
Yeah.
And he's like, no, you know, he had a little tick to him. Like, stop playing. So, but yeah, Martia, you should probably, if it's something you're probably interested in, I can't remember. I didn't write down her name either, but I'm sure that you can do like an easy search if anybody's.
Probably not going to read the book, but I do want to know, like, if she's on that show, I wouldn't mind watching, like, you know, a little documentary or whatever to see, because I'm always curious as
about
to
the kids.
How this stuff affects the kids.
And the wife, I'm not sure if she's still alive at this point, or, but she divorced him in 2005 after that arrest, so looks like she was. I mean, can you imagine, like, because they was in that town for decades. Like, everybody knows you in town.
I cannot imagine. Right.
And then your husband is this person that did all this. I would have to definitely move. Hopefully she moved out of there, because I'd
probably be in therapy for the rest of my life.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, the Grim Sleeper, you remember when we did his case, his wife never relocated. She stayed in the same area. They just know not to talk to her and ask questions about him.
I'd be so scared.
I would, too. you know.
Right.
But, oof. Okay. Well, that's the end of that for Dennis Rader. Let's close the book on him. But goodness, he was, they have many shows about him, though. Many shows and many, like the TV shows and also movies I know they have about him, which I can't look at any of them.
He probably committed more murders mm-hmm. than they were able to, you know, link back to him. And that's just tragic.
Which I don't, because even though he confessed to each one of them and he told them how he killed all of them, I still think there might be some more out there that they just didn't find and he too. Just left it. Or he might forgot. I don't know if he forgot them or not, because he probably didn't. But yeah, I just think that's a big, long stretch. Like, how do you go from, you know, couple of years and you don't do anything, but it's something like you're craving, like a fantasy that you need, and you just stop for years? How does that work? I don't know. So on this episode, Sippers, we're introducing a new segment called A Quickie. This is where we get right to the point and tell you the true crime story, hot off the presses, or something that was down deep in the crates that we had to dig out. So let me know what you guys think about this segment. I'm not sure if you guys remember hearing this, Sippers and ladies. And it was 2018. Keith Smith told the police that his wife was stabbed and robbed by a man that she was trying to hand $10 to. Like, it was a panhandler. She was giving money to a panhandler, and then they ended up stabbing her in Baltimore. Yeah, in Baltimore.
Yeah, I heard about this. Yeah.
Okay. So I remember hearing about that, and everybody's like, oh my gosh, that's why I wouldn't give any money, or that's why I don't do this, because, you know, there's no telling. Right. Like, the panhandler actually killed this woman.
Until the plot twist.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay.
So, right. And the story drew national attention as he and his daughter, Valeria, I think that's how you pronounce her name, Valeria, gave an interview about, you know, about how it happened and how the panhandler stabbed his wife and, you know, lost without her and all this stuff. And everybody was so brokenhearted for him. And, you know, because can you imagine you try to help somebody and then they stab you? So that's a compelling story. But the story fell short when the detectives failed to find evidence of the panhandler, and surveillance video and cell phone data didn't show that the Smith's car was along that route that he claimed that they took. See, I tell you guys, these computers, these phones and all this stuff will give you away.
GPS ping.
Right. Like, it's everything is being tracked. Cameras everywhere. It's just, it's harder and harder to try to fool people now when you have a digital footprint everywhere. So Keith Smith and his daughter were arrested in March of 2019 in Texas when they were trying to escape to the Mexican border. Child, they was trying to get the hell out of Dodge after they figured out that they was about to be caught because they lied. So Valeria Smith, his daughter, who pleaded guilty in 2019 to acting as an accessory after her stepmother slaying, because this was her stepmother, not her mother, after her stepmother's slaying, admitted to ditching her stepmother's purse at a bus stop to support the panhandler story that her dad came up with. She testified that her father drove them into a park as his wife dozed. Then he stabbed her. Afterward, Keith Smith coached his daughter on what they would tell the police. Valeria Smith was sentenced in December 2021 to 5 years in prison under a plea deal in which she agreed to testify against her father. In March of 2022, just recently, Keith Smith was sentenced to life in prison for murder, plus 3 years to be served concurrently for the use of a deadly weapon. So he got caught, his daughter got caught. But my question to you Sippers and ladies, would you rat out your daddy?
Yep.
No, you wouldn't.
I would. I'm not going to jail for you. And I mean, and listen to the storyline, though. Yes, the panhandler, like, stabbing her. Why didn't you just drive off or speed off or get out and try to fight him? Like, no, get off my way. Come on. It just
didn't sound right.
Yeah, I wouldn't have. No.
I mean, it sounded compelling at the beginning. You know, like, if you think about it, you're like, oh, my gosh, you know, like, and you'll be on his side. But at least, why? I don't know. It just fell apart. Just
and you know what? I'm not even going to tell my dad I'm snitching. I'm like, I'm telling on you.
Yeah.
What about you, Renee? Would you?
I'm thinking about it. I probably would. I'll tell on him.
I'm not going to jail. That's not a fit uniform for me.
I have a cool relationship with my dad, but you know, like, that was your wife that you killed. Like, what?
Yeah, you did that.
And see, I was wondering if the young lady, you know, didn't like her stepmom and she took part in the crime. So I didn't even know.
Yeah, I never did see that she took part other than her dishing the purse.
And right.
She was saying that she didn't know about it until after, well, when it was happening, but it wasn't nothing that she plotted. But I don't know about that part. Yeah. So she'll be in jail for 5 years, but her daddy's serving life. So, I mean,
I probably would tell. I mean, I hate to admit that. Honestly, I do.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't, I can say that because my dad was not in my life. So it's not like he'll be listening and be like, you.
Yeah.
That's okay. I'm going to tell my dad.
So
I'm about to say, you have a good relationship with your dad.
I am, but I do. And you know what? I'm going to tell him. Dad, I'm going to tell him. You do something to her.
I'm surprised that that's Demetrius's answer that she's
right. I'm sticking to it because I'm not going down.
To her dad.
I love my parents. I will come visit. I will put stuff on your books, but I'm not going down. For
I don't
you
believe
you want to be stupid. Nope.
I don't know.
If my dad was my best friend like Demetrius and her dad, I ain't telling.
I'm telling.
Just thinking about.
Demetrius, I don't know. I don't think you will, but.
Poor daddy.
I'm
telling.
And he going to jail for life for the rest of his life?
Yeah, I'm gonna have to.
The thing
tell
is, it looks like they just
needed
a confession.
Him and put money on his books.
I'll put money and I'll visit. I'm like, hi, how are you?
I will block your ass from visiting me. Like anybody.
It's all right. I'll disguise as somebody else and then come in here and visit. I'm like, hi, I'm his lawyer.
Mm-mm. But for the deadbeat dads who just wasn't in their kids' lives, that would be me. I'm telling.
Yeah, right, right.
But if I was close to my dad, I'm probably gonna run away with him to Mexico. We hiding out,
right? Because they were going to Mexico.
I'm gonna have to call y'all three way and have my dad on the phone. Be like, Dad, I'm telling you to do something tomorrow.
See, because what it sounds like was that the police just needed somebody's testimony. All she had to do was be quiet. So if that's all you had to do is just be quiet and your daddy won't get caught, you will still tell on him just to make sure that you don't get caught up into that, Demetrius?
Yeah, because you know they follow you for a minute. And you know how you have those.
Demetrius is not with it. She's like,
yeah.
No.
You know how you had that workman's comp and you do the claim and they still follow you for years to see if your leg's still hurting. And
oh
then they go, oh, his leg ain't. That's how they do for these crime scenes.
60 minute special reports on that.
I have. I'm telling you. I just can't go down.
But all jokes aside, because of the victim, I probably would at some point tell, even if we was tight, because that's just sad.
Yeah, that was your stepmother. Yeah.
To have, you know, gotten killed like that. And if he had gotten away with it, then there would be no justice for her side of the family. So.
That's true.
I probably would sleep on it and think about it like that. And even if I went 5 days of not telling, I probably would end up confessing because that would cause me to have nightmares. I'm sorry if I know that her killer's out there, you know. And then if he was that callous to kill his wife, ain't no telling. He might get mad at his daughter one day. Mm-hmm. You just never know because we've seen a lot of crime TV and we know some people will kill their children if they don't do what they're supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Gosh. That's kind of that, yeah. And then, I mean, yeah. Because, I mean, if she had anything to do with it beforehand, then whatever, then she deserved to be in jail. But if she was just there and then it happened, and then now she got a cover.
And what was his real motive? For money?
I don't even
know.
Or
just to get rid of her? Like,
I think maybe to get rid of her. I don't know.
I thought it was just like divorce. Just didn't want to be with her anymore. Yeah.
I mean, just leave at this point.
That money was a part of it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly.
At this point, just leave. Why even just run away? You know, like see those movies where the husband just disappears. Just disappear.
I still don't understand that.
They didn't have a panhandler that they were going after.
Right.
You know, like you said, it was a lot of surveillance because it's a
they
good thing that was the case.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. They would have took some innocent person right on into jail. That's I can't stand when people commit crimes and then try to drag other people into it.
Yeah,
and get them in trouble to take the focus
exactly.
Off of
and I mean, if they would have took if they would have took an innocent person, he would probably wouldn't even care and just would lived his life on just the way it was,
Right,
probably gotten all the sympathy from people still because they're like, oh my gosh, poor you, your wife was taken from you, just sickening. But I'm glad you got caught.
Exactly.
That story was really sad.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, let's go swing over on a lighter note. What we're gonna do, we're gonna
go to our Take Another Sip segment. So this is where we discuss something that really caught us off guard, surprised us. Maybe it made us laugh or cry for some, but not this one. This is going to make us laugh. But either way, it's going to make us wonder what, ladies?
Take another sip.
Hey.
Hey.
We love sipping. You know how we do.
I'm ready.
So my question is, I'm laughing before I even ask you guys because I want to see what you guys are going to say. How long did it take? How long were you with your partner before you guys tooted in front of them?
You're so childish.
What do you mean? Like
every time she asks a question, I always have to remember how like childish she could be sometimes.
Oh my gosh.
Mm-hmm. Is that a real question?
It's a real question.
Man, I don't remember how long it was, but I'll tell you that we still joke about how long it had to be because it was like, your stomach had to really be in pain sitting around me and you wasn't trying to poop. But I don't know how long it was.
Like years or months?
I can't remember. That's just not something I've kept stored in my brain. But I know I had to have not done it for a minute, but I don't know how long
it was. Let me tell you something. I'm not going to hold myself till I die. That's a fact. If I got to go,
you did it right off the bat.
It was right off the bat. You know me, I'm rude though. I'm a Scorpio at heart. It's like, whatever. You either take it, whatever. You know, that's me. But I don't know. I'm going to have to ask. And then we'll do an update on that.
How about you, Renee?
Well, I still haven't.
Wait.
On like, just to do it, just to do it. But if it happens to slip out, I'd be like, oops, excuse me. But I don't try to push something out of me. You know, just like, it is what it is. Oh, man. Well, I know my sister, and I got this story. I'm not sure if she has now. I know she was saying that she doesn't in front of her husband. And my sister's been married. And if you're listening, hey, girl, hey.
Hey, girl, hey.
She's been married for like 21 years, something like that.
I'm going to have to ask. I think mine was like the first year or something. I didn't care.
Yeah, and I think she still doesn't. I mean, I'm not sure if she has or not. But forcibly, she doesn't. Yeah. She wouldn't do that.
Yeah. Well, you know, when you work in healthcare, you notice that certain things can kill you. So that's not going to be something I'm going to hold in. I'm not dying for a fart.
Okay, well, that leads to my story that I have for you.
Okay.
Take another sip. There you go.
All right.
Thank you for the segue, girl.
So, okay, well, there we go.
A Brazilian songstress. And I'm going to try to pronounce her name. And if I have it wrong, forgive me. Vivian de Queiroz Pereira, she was hospitalized after her reluctance to fart in front of her significant other, and it resulted in a dangerous gas buildup. So she woke up at like 5:30 in the morning with severe stomach pains and ended up in the hospital with trapped gas. So trapped gas occurs when methane does not move through one's intestines normally, causing people to have sharp pains or discomfort in the abdomen. So, however, this condition is generally caused by certain foods or an underlying medical condition like, you know, IBS or something like that. But it is a thing. Trapped gas. And you can end up in the hospital if you do not fart.
Wow. I did not know that.
Ding, 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 ding.
I'm going to say, she's going to be like, I knew.
I knew.
Right.
And no need of me holding in nothing. Number two, number
and
one.
I'm glad that I don't hold it because that would be crazy to end up in the hospital with.
Can you imagine how bad it has to be that you have to go to the hospital because you ain't fart?
Yes.
Like, I'm going to let it out. It's just going to be like quiet.
And let me tell you something. No nurses and doctors like, you wasted my time because you refused to. Okay, you will get coded. They'll be like, you gonna go in room 202? No, she all right.
Dang.
I'm trying to tell you.
So I'm good. But I say this is a note to our sippers. Y'all fart. I mean, it ain't gotta be loud and nasty.
Let it out.
Just excuse yourself, but don't just hold it all in.
Don't hold it in.
Because that is dangerous and it can kill you.
It can kill you. You can die.
But, I don't know what methane gas is, but it sounds very toxic if that's in your body.
It sure does.
Wow. Like, I'm not sure what it does, but.
Release, relax, relate, and release. Just let it go.
Ciao. But yeah, so that's going to be our closing thought for today.
Girl, just fart.
There you go. I don't even want to say guys just fart, because usually they just do. Like, they don't care.
Yeah. But, and the silent but deadly ones.
Girl.
Just excuse yourself to another room. You already know.
Yeah, you know. They be playing games with it and stuff. You know, like, I got you. I got you with your mouth open.
Oh.
Or be under the covers and stuff.
Wait a minute.
It'd be under the covers and you don't know it until you move or something. You'd be like, what's up? Or is that just me?
You know, it's not quiet. We got
I'm going to excuse myself.
You said catch him with your mouth open.
Yeah.
I was like, wait, you by yourself, sis.
Oh, my God. Hopefully we made you guys, you sippers, laugh or smile a little bit with this disturbing story. You know, you got to think of the good things in life, and glad that this monster has been captured and he's in prison for the rest of his life.
Actually
brings me joy that he just kept taunting and kept going at it until he got caught, so good for him.
Right.
So it's time to say goodbye, guys.
No,
already. It's time to say goodbye, and you guys have a wonderful
No more segments.
That's it.
Oh, man.
But sippers,
encore.
You know, if you guys still need more, you go look at listen to our old episodes. If you haven't been caught up on them, go on and do it now. But that's it for today. So we'll be here every Tuesday with new episodes.
Every single Tuesday. True Crime Tuesday is our favorite day of the week.
All right. Well, you guys have a good day, ladies. And bye, sippers. Thanks for listening.
Bye, ladies. Bye, sippers.
Bye.